Thank you all so much. It feels like such an honor to be here and it's so exciting to be here with the Southern Voices Festival. And thank you so much to the Southern Voices Committee, the Hoover Library, and particularly the Fine Arts Department, and to Jennifer Marshall. But so I am going to talk about the book process that I did, and I'm going to sort of weave work that's older and also looking forward. So and sort of ending up with more current installations and views. So if you will just, we'll sort of start here. The monograph, Threads and Layers, was just a really big project that I had no idea how big a book project is. And so I learned a huge amount and I continue. But it was also a gift. It was a gift to have so many conversations, and a lot of some people here that are so important part of this are in the picture right there, because it was really the process and the people and all of that that helped to move this. It was started in 2018 in the fall and went to press in the fall of 2020. So during the pandemic, also, you know, it was great to have such a major process project to be working on then. We're going to look at a sort of short video that kind of talks about this book and some of the process.
I'm Sara Garden Armstrong. I lived in New York City for over 35 years working as an artist. I've now moved back home to Alabama to continue this work as an artist. A few years ago, I received a grant to archive my art. This began the process of looking back at a very diverse body of work from four decades. This eventually led me to make a decision to do a book, to understand, to investigate the threads and concepts that run through the work and what inspires me even to today. The book began with a publisher, but I found that I had to step away. I had to be in control of something that was so important and personal to me.
So this is the hardbound. When that video was taken, I was still very much in the process of working on the book. And it has also a limited edition where there's a unique drawing in each one that's in the slipcase there. Just another, as a visual artist, you know, we do things visually. So even though a lot of people were working on the words and that, I had to really do this where this would have been an essay, and I'm really putting the images that were possible in that. And then I'm also printing out. So it was in constant sort of change. I was able in the studio to look at a book and look at it visually on the wall and see how does it move, how does it do. And I also realized, which was surprising to me, is that as you turn the pages, this is a confined space that you have as a canvas or a sculpture, an installation. So you are thinking about how that space is and how this image relates to another, and the words have to go in there too. But it was, you know, it was my large concern was very much thinking of the visual images. Now, I've just jumped back to 1977. I have finished my MFA and I'm at UAB teaching. And this is the first show that I'm doing after graduate school. And I graduate as a painter, and I don't... But I never stayed flat. And you can see on this one here, it began touching the wall and then it ended up just being a piece of sculpture. With this show, I came down, I also realized that it was something very interesting about it, that I really liked walking through the form sitting on the floor. So this very much started me in the direction of sculpture. And I do think of myself as as drawing in space with sculpture. It's, you know, it began very early on, and I've always thought of myself as an artist, not as a painter or a sculptor or drawing. It's just you are doing the medium that you think you need to do that piece in. But I wanted to show you, this was sometimes yellow, and it was this piece right here was in that show. And you see right down here, you can see where the drawing that is in this exhibition, where it came from. So early on, I was always working with flat and also with dimension. It's been something that has just been part of my work. And when the book started, it was mainly sculpture, and I realized, no, the largest body of work I have is flat. And it's, you know, I'm saying it's a painting or a drawing, but anything flat. And so it has been, it's a real important thinking process, it's a real of understanding what I'm trying to do. So this piece of work came out of this. The one where everything looked so much more interesting sitting on the floor than it was at the show. So I spent about a year working on these forms. And there's wooden structures inside. I even showed them with the wooden structures. But it's canvas stretched over these forms and airbrushed. And during this process, there was a fellow faculty member that also said that, what about adding sound? And I thought, that's a pretty good idea. So I had speakers put in these forms at different directions in these that were just in, you know, one might be here facing there, another might be down here. So they became much more conversation people. And the forms, I was moving them around the studio. And so when this show happened, you might imagine that there's no way that I could have liked sound that someone else did. It just didn't, it wasn't going to work. Not when you have worked so hard on something. And so what happened with this is I decided I would have to do sound. And so what I did was I had a recording inside the piano, and one person, Scott, I see there, is laughing because he was one that went with me to record all this sound and worked with me a lot. But what we did, we recorded it, then I used the pieces themselves to structure how the sound would be organized. You know, how would it be scored? And with that, and so that was how I was able to, you know, step into sound, that the art, the structure, the forms themselves helped me determine the scoring. And so this piece was not shown. I'm going to jump over here. Okay, this is current right now, 2020 and 2021. I showed this piece for the first time since 1979 when I did a very large installation in Fat Village, which was 8,000 square feet space. That's this space. You needed to walk within there. It was very much about the body feeling the sound physically and the conversation moving around in it. So now we're just going to keep jumping a little bit. So some of the other work is the air players. And this was the first essay in the book that was done by Dan Talley. It's Drawing Breath. And in this, he really traces how the sound moved and changed and developed through the installation, my installations, up from the very early piece that you just saw, and with that. And I'm going to sort of talk a little bit about this Air Player series. It began, so let me back up and say, before, when I did sound installations here, I had the entire space to myself. I did not have to compete. At this point, I'm moving to New York. I've just gotten in a group show at PS1. PS1 is now part of the Museum of Modern Art, but it was not then, and which was very exciting. And so, but I was going to have to compete with other artists with their sound. And I was not going to do that. So what I did, so here you see their drawings. It's hard to see that a lot of these drawings have a sort of dot pattern. And for me in this, this was always talking about how sound moved in space. So I decided that I would translate one of those drawings into a, into a piece of sculpture. I'm thinking I'm hitting this. And this was it. So I'm also working with sheetrock in my place and my studio where I'm building a sort of kitchen law space. So that was a material I was using. So what basically I did was I have holes that are copper tubes and air is moving out of each hole one after another. So in order to get that to happen, it ended up, I built a box in the back. It's connected hoses to it. And so I love this piece, but the most exciting thing about it was the blower boxes on the backside. And so after this piece, I always had the breathing, because that's what it was. It was breathing. This piece is a piece that was at the Birmingham Museum. And you can see here, these are these little blower boxes. They're squirrel cage blowers. And I'm using a relay switch where it's off and on, and there's a sort of gentle movement. I am painting shadows, and I'm casting shadows. So I'm airbrushing shadows on the wall. And, you know, I'm trying to think about what about those shifts of reality? What's real? What's not? And I don't think I've ever been able to leave it. I've sort of keep thinking about that and continue with that. This is the next piece. This was at Great Jones Street, and I had a studio on the ground floor. And I decided that I would turn my studio into a gallery. I put a listed in the gallery guide, and had an exhibition. It's also important that I now, upstairs here, these are being run by a computer. And so the blower now has become an instrument. It, you know, there's a control, the sound, the off and on switching, that there's a short, a long, and I worked with a great guy, Nick Dukowski, with organizing this, and it kept getting more and more complicated until it got simpler. Now, these you can see, the prints, I just say a little bit about some of the work that's out there. This was an etching. The next one was an etching, but I also here, I airbrushed on the paper before with a stencil before they were printed. And then the next one over here was a litho, and it was... Each one is a different, like a mono print, because I use graphite, charcoal, and I use the litho just as a base. And then the earliest one down here, you notice the title is not Air Player. It says, what do we stand? At this moment in time, I'm on Hester Street, which is the Lower East Side. I have a harassment from the landlord. He would like for me to leave. And so I do this series of what do we stand? So this is another book project, and it was one of the reasons I thought that I could do this book project was I had been doing these installations. This is getting to be 90 now, and I wanted to travel more. And with installations, you know, you go in, it's not something that's particularly for sale. it's at a museum, it might take, you could be up longer, you might have gotten a grant for some of it, but I wanted something I could travel with that talked about the air player installations. And so this was a book, and inside it opened up and there's a little environment. I'm going to show just a short little video now. That sound is a digitized blower. And there is this environment, you're looking in at it. I'm living next to a sandblaster at this moment in time, so there's a lot of sandblasting there. It has a small book, it has a recharger, it has a manual to tell you how to do. This little book has a light in it. I sort of met the world with this. I would sand those LEDs for the book at the robotics lab at NYU. So it was a great experience. But something that recently just happened while I put this in is that I was thinking about the installation of the latest air player that is at the that was at the Gadsden Museum, and I thought this air player little environment really told me about moving forward with that, because I'm using four projectors. The viewer is sort of in the piece with the part of the projectors. There's a digitized ocean sound that is in there. So it was surprising to me how, again, we look forward and back all the same time. So this piece right here, Sentient Matrix, is at UAB. It's in the Civitan building, which is right across from where the women's hospital is. And it was a commission from the Multiple Sclerosis Society. And it was honoring Milligori, and he asked me to do a piece, but he said, it has to be about MS. So this was a really hard piece for me. I first didn't understand the disease. My studio became like an image with a lab. I worked with so many people at UAB studying and trying to think, and finally realizing that what I was trying to do was to communicate what MS was about. So this right here is sort of an abstraction of a brain with sort of this would be the spinal cord for me is what it felt like. And we'll look at a video, but it has, these are the neurons, and I ended up with having LEDs to move through them because they could be programmed. And at this point right here, this would be the glia cells in this building. They are also working on, at that time, the glia support for the neuron. And so these were just parts of it. Now, I'm going to show the studio. So here you can sort of see the working with this. You know, I'll just back up and say, when I did the model, I had no idea how this was going to be built. But, you know, it worked. And I should have understood that paper, I've dealt with paper for so long. So here it is spraying the forms, and it goes spraying paper, and this is an abaca fiber, so the light can go through it easily. And then you have to empty that inside. Here's where the forms have been emptied, trying to figure out if I have enough length for the runs. Here is the glia that was working on. This was the model. And with this piece, it had to be exacting. If you're connecting LEDs, you cannot not have that. They've got to connect. And here is worked with a great guy with programming the LEDs and going through the whole experiment of it. Now, this is the video of installing.
And then we're doing this, yeah.
So we installed everything with a temporary cord. And until we could figure out whether that was an okay. It was a, I did have the luxury of taking as much time as I needed with this install. So when the light turns red, which I just missed showing you, but you saw the red light, that indicated that you couldn't move an arm. So throughout the piece, there were points where the light would turn red and just stop. So that was the blockage. It would have been right in there. See, that one wasn't moving. I learned that it was really great to work in Birmingham and that this might be a really good place to move back to. So what I'm getting ready next to do is we're going to go through a couple of short videos. One is going to be about the installation of the exhibition at Fat Village in Fort Lauderdale, and then we're going to go to Gadsden and then to the painting show. So I'm just going to sort of, I'll talk over them if it's okay. So this is that 8,000 square foot space, the largest I have ever dealt with. But you know, it's nice to be pushed and be able to pull out things that you didn't know. This piece right here, this, was an older forms and I used to make it an arch with the projectors sort of indicating where the sound would have been. This is the pulling out the air player piece, of which then I've done in another three times. This you can see the influence of the LEDs from the sentient piece. Again, a lot of this work is about breathing. This was a skin rack that was done at the Bronx Museum when I did that. But again, the environment, this was the first time to show that in so very long, since 79. This was really great because showing in Gadsden, I was able to show those very large littoral drawings that were about the water's edge. It just allowed, the space allowed for very different types of work to be shown all at the same time. And this was a very early drawing with the Air Player series. So the last video I'm just going to click is the one that I just said I did a painting show that's up right now in New York. And so this is the opening for this painting show. So this sort of concludes. I'd love if anyone has any questions. Does anybody? Oh, yes.
If God said, this is it, Sarah, what are you going to bring with you, what would you pick?
I don't know. I don't know. That would be really hard. I don't know. I think I'd just do something else. Yes.
How long did it take you to do the MS piece?
That was really hard because I had never dealt with light movement. And, you know, I knew that I had to have light. and it had to move. And I had to figure out, go through so many things and be so lost. But I knew, you know, so it was over a year. Wow. Yeah. It just, and I, that's all I worked on mainly during that period, was that piece. And I did it, I was still in New York, but that was when I first got a studio down here in this old building I have. So it, you know, it was good.
What gallery is that, New York gallery?
It's Stephanie Marks Gallery. It's at 78th and Madison.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
What is Fat Village?
Fat Village, Becky.
Right,
yeah, Becky, you want to, that, I'll explain and you can correct me. Okay, Doug McGraw, who is Becky Patterson's brother, has a very large space. He has a whole sort of community of artists and shop stores and all in this area in Fort Lauderdale, which is just getting ready to be, is being renovated some. And he has this one very large space that he shows, you know, projects in, and I was get. So that's what it is. I probably didn't answer it, but.
He had art shows once in a while.
Yeah. That, mine was up 3 months.
Sarah,
yes.
What kind of pigment did you use on your painting chair?
So the paintings, the paintings are not paint. I'm using abaca fiber mixed, which is that banana leaf fiber, you know, that's fiber in a, put in a bucket and all. And then I'm putting pigment that is used in war, I mean, in paper making. So it's a very strong, and I'm pouring that. I'm painting horizontally, and then it has to dry. I'll manipulate it some, but it has to dry. And then I'll have to put it up to look at what I'm doing. It takes, it's, you know, it's just sort of a longer process. Sometimes I'm peeling some of that off. Sometimes I'm putting some of it back on. Like, oh, I've got my, this. So if you look right here, this little piece has been added to that. And I touched the wrong thing. Oh, I went the wrong way, I'm sorry. But that was what? Some of that has been, even though it's light, that was at, that was peeled off of another place and added.
So if you had each of those pieces peeled up, you get, they're actually translucent.
You can see, you can, there's still, it depends on the thickness.
Yeah.
There's, you know, in my studio there's tons of just, you know, but I do peel and put back. It's a sort of ghost image. Yeah, in Tuscaloosa, I did the MFA. I went around the first time with elementary education, and I came back around the second time, directly starting at the museum in Birmingham, taking classes, and directly to UAB for all undergraduate and to Tuscaloosa. So when I finally figured it out, I just went a little bit straight.
Did you ever teach? I taught
elementary school, and then I taught at UAB a little bit.
What's your favorite medium? You know,
whatever I'm doing at the moment. You know, you only you're wherever you are, that's what's the best. And so that was one of the interesting things about the book, going back and looking back and thinking about, you know, well, that was pretty good. I guess it's okay. You know, you're still looking and how does this connect and how does it connect to something else?
Did you ever work with metal?
Yes. I did. I had a welder at one point. I did a little bit of, like, the skin rack welding of that. I worked with Brad Morton somewhere. We did a piece where he did the metal and I did the paper. So just a little bit. I tend to, you know, I mentioned drawing in space. So I tend to have lighter forms, and I don't really deal with mass very much. So, if
you,
yes.
So you had a showing there at the end,
yeah,
in New York.
Yes.
So I assume those were for sale.
Yes.
But the larger pieces, you know, airplay,
uh-huh,
things like that.
Uh-huh.
Are those for sale?
Well, they're just, you know, they're installations. You'd have to have a place for it. You know, they're not priced to sell. Because, you know, that's the reason I was saying I did the airplay of the book. Because you do these things and you spend all of your money and time doing them. And it, you know, you have to earn money to do this. Right. Yeah. Yes. Yes.
So you invested a year in the MS piece. Have you done any more pieces like that?
No. You have to get a commission. But the MS piece, you did see the piece that had the light moving in it. Yeah, I did that one first at Space 111, and then I moved it. It actually traveled, and each place it became another piece. Yes.
So what was your inspiration for using sound with your installation?
So, you know, that was really, the way I started, I don't think I ever would have gone there, but I had these forms with speakers, and I wanted to do something with that. So that started me. And then when I was showing you the air player, that first air and that hoses, so that was just so interesting to me in the backside where these tubes were breathing. And I so, you know, and that just became more. And then, you know, then you want these blower boxes to become instruments, and, you know, everything leads to something else. So maybe it's time for us to have a reception. Wait, let me ask one more. Yes. And you'll have to, I'm working on that. I have an old building that I love downtown, and we have a lot of studios in it. We have a gallery, ground floor, contemporary, and I and the Alabama Center for Architecture is there. And, you know, I would like, I want so much for Birmingham to keep growing and in the art community to keep being together and supportive and move us all forward. So I'm just doing my little part. Thank you for that question.